You are the living God, Lord. Is there no one like you? You are the living God, Lord. Is there no one like you? See how you rescue the sea. See how you deliver us. You are the living God, Lord. Is there no one like you? Recue-me, 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 recue-me. You are the living God. Is there no one like you? You are the living God. Is there no one like you? Tell us back your way. Give him praise, give him all the honor, give him all the thanks. We have come again to come again to all that. We have come again to come and fellowship together as brethren. Not that we don't know this word individually, not that we cannot study on the Bible on our own, but there is a power, an extra power that goes into manifestation when we come together as a body, when we come together in one voice, when we come together in unison, when we come together in unity. Open your mouth and begin to talk to God and stand in the same name. Give him praise, give him all the glory. Hey, saw this name, I saw this name. He has done it again, he has done it again. What a mighty God we serve. Thank you, Jesus. We are done, we give you praise. We are done, we give you praise. We are done with the praise. We give you praise. We give you the praise. Rapa suda ya na 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 Lord, I magnify your praise. I give you all the honor. I give you all the thanks. Thank you for the possibility to gather. Thank you for the possibility to gather. Thank you for the strength to display your word to your people. Spirit of the God, I invite you. Hey, come and take charge. Come and take charge. Come and take charge. In Jesus' name we have worshiped. Let's begin to invite his presence. Let's begin to talk to him. Come and take charge. Come and take charge of this gathering tonight. Father, we invite you. Take charge, Lord. Take charge, Lord. Take charge, Lord. Take charge, Lord. Read upon the God is gathering. Read upon the God, every word that will come out of my mouth. Read upon the people that are connecting, Lord God. Come and do a new thing. Lord God Almighty, sweet Holy Spirit, we invite you to come and do a new thing. Lord God, Jehovah, we are tired of our old life. Lord God, kingdom, that we are ready to father Jehovah, to put all God away. Lord God, the old coins came, Lord God, King of the Ring. A father ready to hold God to put on, Lord God, King of the Ring before you tonight. The new wine skin, Lord God, so that Lord God, new wine might be poured into it. Because the word God says, God, we cannot put new wine, Lord God, into the old wine skin. Please, Lord God, the Lord God, King of glory, yes, God, the skin, God, possible, God, and the father, the one they wasted. And father, we already know you are not a waster. You are not a waster. So therefore, if you must heal us up, Lord God, we must be ready. We must, Lord God, turn in your name, Lord God. And we're asking you to have mercy tonight in the name of Jesus. We want to hear your word, God, that will bring a transformation. We want to hear your word that will direct us. We want to hear your word that will correct us. We want to hear your words, God, that will rebuke us. The Bible says, God, to whom you love, to shed eyes, because you take delight in our welfare. Lord God, King of them, we become the best, God. And just to shed eyes, I want to come tonight. Father, may he call Lord God to us, God, and the ability to receive in the name of Jesus Christ. Grace, God, let grace go with you tonight. Let grace go with you tonight. Let not let the truth be released, God, because many a times we receive the truth of your word. When it lasts, the grace of God, we cannot, Lord God, comprehend. We cannot cope, Lord God, at the end of the day, we remember where we are. Hence, God, we are asking for the grace to receive the truth. And Lord God, King of God, begin to turn. And Father, begin to serve for righteousness. The Bible says righteousness is not a nation. Sin is a reproach, God. We ask help us tonight. Help us tonight. Help us tonight. Help us tonight. Yes. To your word, God, in the name of Jesus, God. I come, Lord God, to your mouth, God. I submit myself under your leadership. Prepare, Lord God, your work to me, Lord. Be thou exalted. Bless up your holy name. 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 Sweet Holy Spirit, take charge. Sweet Holy Spirit, take charge. Breathe upon every side, Lord God. Breathe upon every life, Lord God. Breathe upon every life, Lord God. Breathe upon every life, Lord. Hey, now the name of Jesus Christ. We are going to Lord. Bless up your holy name. time to sit on the spirit. I submit myself, Lord God, by your leadership, Lord. Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we are praying.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise Pastor Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. I say hi to everyone. God bless you. Depending on where you are watching me from, yes, a part of the world. Hey, I'm going to say good morning, good afternoon, good evening. God bless you all. Amen. To those on Zoom, I say good evening. God bless you. Amen. Hallelujah. Those on YouTube, God bless you all. Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. As you so I want to appreciate you all for coming online. For coming online, it is a privilege. And it's something that gives me joy to do. Because without you, this this video tonight, this streaming tonight, will be useless. It is you, yeah, that the hope that keeps me on every week to prepare the message, knowing that you are rightful here, you're willing to listen and also to create a change in your life. That is what keeps me bubbling every week to prepare you things by the help of the Holy Spirit for you to come and listen and also to bring a positive change in your life. And I see your life being redirected tonight by the power of God in Jesus' name. That at the end of today's service, you have a testimony in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to the Master Jesus. Amen. For a while now, we have been on the topic. Let's see what we can do. The Holy Spirit will help us to do tonight. We have been on a topic that has to do with what do you do when you fall? What do you do when you fall? What do I do when I fall as a Christian? What do I do when I fall as a Christian? That goes to tell us that at what point in time not that God expects us to fall. No, I wouldn't say that because that is not the expectation of God for us. If I say that, that's to say that God expects us to always go back. Because when you fall as a Christian, it actually retardates your movement. Now, when I talk about fall this evening, I mean that one. When you sin, when you err against the truth. And like the other time I made us understand sin here, that we want a lot of definition I'm giving to sin. But because in this context, we are dealing with. Because you what is on ground, we are dealing with as God will help all the spirit. It has to do with when you miss a mark. That's to say that this is what God expects you to do, but one way or the other, you didn't do it. One way or the other, you missed it and left you, or you overdid it. That is what we are talking about, actually, here. And which every one of us is guilty of, including I, that is teaching tonight. You know, since all of us, God, but what did I say? All of us, we are guilty of it. Can I see at least one person tonight? One person tonight that will identify and says, by God, born again, I don't know what is causing. The Holy Spirit has never convinced me of one thing. Can I see at least one person in our midst? None of us. No wonder the Bible says that all the sin are come short of the glory of God. But with thank God, we have a remedy through the blood of Jesus Christ. So when we miss the mark, one will fall short of the glory of God. What is not expected of us? Because I made us understand by the help of the Holy Spirit, when we miss my thoughts of which to just run away from God, or we just hold our hands. I remember years ago in Africa, in the course of evangelism, went out for evangelism one evening, and I continued to meet a brother. And this brother, he wasn't a member of our church anyway. I do know he attends a church, you know, outside that, not too far away from our church then. But as long as I started, I met him, and I was just greeting him. Because once he went to our church, he's not able to go to his church because his church is further than our home. Because our home is closer to his house. But I do remember that he was a very committed member of that church he was with. I ran into him in the first evangelism. I was just exchanging greetings with him. High stress and everything. I was hard to hear from that. I no longer go to church. And you know, the truth about the matter was though I was not happy with the same thing, at the same time, I was happy, but he saw the truth. But like some of us, we cover the truth so much and we end up in destruction. May that not be a portion in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. This brother actually opened up to me and said, no, I sister, I no longer go to church. I said, what happened? It has to take time. I have to, by the help of the Holy Spirit, I have to dig deep, you know, encourage him, and he has to open up to me that yes, many. Advice he has only into sin, and what was that? The sin of fornication that he just said that is he can no longer again let it just commit with his life. Now, as he talks to me at that evening, that already had the sister at home, they are not living together. Though he knows that the sin that he's living in, he has tried to stay away, but he cannot. So he just decided to commit living his life like that. But by the only effort, the Holy Spirit, I was able to talk to him, you know. So, what am I trying to say here is that you see, that brother, one way or the other, he fell. He felt, and he was not saying that I just want to give it up concerning Christianity, that he doesn't want to be a pretender. He doesn't want to go to church and pretend, whereas inside he knows what he's doing. So he wants to really go back to the world and just call it a quit. You see, that is how some of us we have become. I know the devil has sold too much to feed us, and God is so happy with such situation. Look at the story of the prodigal son, Luke chapter 15 from verse 11. Look at his situation there. Yes, he misbehaved. Great time, he misbehaved big time before the father. You know, his father, the father wept. And when the father gathered the, you know, drink during his life, and it wasn't an easy job for his father. He squandered it, he went far away with prostitute. And when he was to come back, he came back empty-handed. But the father, when he thought he was away, the father had love towards him. The father had was always towards him. So when is he coming back home? And that is how the Holy Spirit expects every one of us that has fallen short of his glory one way or another. God knows at one time or the other will fall. Remember, I made us to understand this also in his word, in the book of Proverbs. You know, the Bible says that's why righteous man will fall seven times and it will rise again. If he knows that we cannot fall, there's no way we made that statement in this world. And if there is no, then if he knows that what, well, there will be no sin, there will not be nothing like forgiveness in the Bible. He knows that no word God will miss it. At times you that think you are perfect, you are with us. At times that even some words we say mistakenly, we say casually, that can be expensive joke. At times we just say, but not knowing that the thought it created the heart of the other person that we are saying we are joking. You know, for the fact that somebody is smiling with you because of your joke, doesn't mean the person is actually in total agreement with what you are saying or is enjoying what you are saying. Inside is the person's mind, it might feel down, it might feel discouraged, it might feel that we are judging him. But at times, people doesn't really have the courage to challenge us because they just smile because of our statement. But I'm not only just had what it felt. But you feel that, well, hey, I'm righteous, nothing, asking as much as what I am not living foundation, adultery, I'm not stealing. But what about the words? What about what? Our secret sin, the thoughts of our heart, the thought of our that we have not actually manifested that sin. But inside of our heart is going on, negative, or no wonder David said in the book of Psalm 119, he said, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable unto you, Lord. Therefore, the way it's come from the heart, the meditation, the thought of my heart, let it be acceptable unto you. Don't let the words of my mouth. You see, all our actions as human, before we can actually manifest it physically, it starts first from my heart. It starts first from my heart. So, what am I saying? This? You that feel that, well, I am perfect. Whatever the situation of your heart. Today, we call, for example, the sin of adultery is when a man actually sleeps with a woman. But in the Old Testament, it is not until he commits the heart. In as far as you have it in your heart, you are already committed the sin. That was in the Old Testament. So you see, at the end of the day, as an example, many other things will fall into you as Christians, as believers. So we have to check ourselves. None is perfect. Why are we teaching this? So that we begin to re-examine ourselves. Remember the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 13, verse 5. He said, examine yourself. You are still in the faith. It's very, very important. Once in a while, we need to go for a thorough check. A thorough shell, like we that live in the developed world, yeah, you know, part of the world. Once in a while, they just advise you to go to the doctor and know, so go, you know, take over a thorough check. At that time, you might not even need to pay for it. They just want to know that to see whether you are okay. Like, for example, as I learned, like the issue of cancer, I learned that there are some cancer when addressed, when noticed early and they begin to treat it, it doesn't actually lead to death. It's when it's not noticed early and got worse. Before it was noticed, that is when it becomes out of, you know, and there's nothing they can do about it, and it can actually end the person up in death. So also our spiritual life, when we are conscious of our lives, there's no way we can miss it with God. There is no way we can miss it with God. I see you arriving safely and in heaven in Jesus' name. Amen. I see Jesus and his angel welcoming you at the end of this journey in the name of Jesus. Amen. None of us will hear from the master and say, go behind me, ye workers of iniquity. That will not be, yes, our portion that day in the name of Jesus Christ. I see you receiving the best from the master. You will be celebrated and you'll be rewarded in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. So what do you do when you sin? As a believer, as a Christian, amen. Last week we saw that number one thing God expects from us when we sin is that we should recognize it. We should recognize it. And by that, wait for that to analyze what does it mean to recognize it, or to realize it, to realize I have sinned. And of course, at times, we don't even know we are sinned. We now know that God, we have clearly sinned by the power of the Holy Ghost. But I will say that what the Spirit of God will give us a conviction. That is what we saw last in the book of John chapter 16, verse 8. He said the Holy Spirit will convince you. It will convince you. You know, many a time, there are some people, at times I look at people, it says, you know, there are people that try to argue with others or make them believe that, no, you have sinned. The person is saying, no, I've not sinned, no. I've not sinned. They say, no, it is a lie, you have sinned, you have begged God. No, that does not come for. If the one of us as Christ carries the Holy Spirit, I don't need to strive with you to convince you that you are sinned. The Spirit inside of you bears you with them. I never force you to say that also the Holy Spirit, we know at times there are things people post, you know, before you that is a sin. But at times when you come to check your spirit, the Spirit is not saying that it's a sin. Please be free to leave. Be free to live. Don't live under condemnation. It's not of God. It is not of God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Because the Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, it says that, well, for them that in Christ Jesus, there's no longer condemnation. There is no longer condemnation. So get this topic tonight. I am not saying you should live in condemnation. No, no, that's in fact, that is why the topic is even coming. So that you know where you have heard and where you have not heard. But the Spirit, by that the Holy Spirit does not convince you. Yes, it does not, you know, it does not judge you. That yes, you, that goes to tell you that you are free. And also, let me see how to eat here. So some of us, God has been convicting of us of some sins. You know, when you start some sin initially, God, the Holy Spirit can convince you of it. Gradually, right? Then when you refuse, that is when he leaves you alone. That is what they call a reprobate heart. What is a reprobate heart? A heart that has been allowed, you know, like God just abandoned that person. I have talked and talked to some of us. It happens by that as human. Has it not happened to you at times? There are some people that are close friends, close relatives. They misbehave and try to correct them again and again, and they are not changing. And then we just concluded in our hearts that I'm going to leave this person alone. Let me leave him or her. He's of age. You know, he's an adult. Anyone wants to live his life, let it go about it. I'm tired of correcting. He doesn't want to change. That is also some believers' life also. That God has abandoned, has left alone. That's what they keep. He has given it to a reprobate heart. So at times, even the Spirit of God does not convince you. That doesn't mean also you are perfect. You have to check yourself. It be that one. In the beginning, that thing has been warning you. Because you refuse to change, it not gives you hope. May you not end up that way in Jesus' name. Yeah. Because at that level is leading to destruction. At that level is leading to destruction. So please, if you find yourself in such situations, man, run back to the master. Run back to the master. The Bible says, it takes not delight in the death of a sinner. It takes not delight in the death of a sinner. No matter how death you are born to, concerning sin, God still wants you back. In fact, what this God joy most is when he see the work sinner be saved. Work sinner be saved. Because why? Before that, somebody that people have given up concerning, they have written up. The way that person is totally transformed. Do you know when people see such a person? Imagine, if, you know, what would I call it? Nonsense criminal. It could know that maybe of course written off to death. All of a sudden, people see that he's not finally born again, genuine born again. He does not involve in such wayward life again. Do you know many people that can see that life and be converted? I say, if this person can become a Christian, then I did not stop me from becoming a Christian because I know that my sin is not as worse as this person. No, you remember I was supporting the Bible. That was the situation. Do you know that post conversion led to the massive conversion of many people in the Bible, because they never talk and it still amazes them. So also you are that, you know, you have gone to that level of your life. And feel that God, there is no way. I'm glad to tell you are the person that God has sent me to tonight to tell you that time has come to turn back. It is not time to give up on yourself. Praise the Lord. Amen. I release upon you the power to change tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. I release upon you the power to live a positive life in Jesus' name. Amen. I release upon you the power to live above sin in the name of Jesus. Amen. Right. The Lord that you do the power of the Holy Ghost from on high. In Jesus' name, to begin to do extraordinary things. Thank you, Lord, tonight. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I will say, recognize yourself, realizing. So this evening, we're going to be continuing with number two. Number two, that what to do when you fall as a believer. Number two is admit or confess your sins. Admit or confess your sins. Admit or confess your sins, your wrongdoing. You know, another word for sins is wrongdoing. Admit. Another word for admit is confess. admit or confess your sins. Admit or confess your sins. You know, when we say admit, so admit, what does it mean? Admission is that what? I realize I have sinned. I realize I have sinned. And I agree with the Holy Spirit who has convinced me of my sin. To admit sin means what? For I to admit my sin, it means that what? I realize I have sinned. I realize I have sinned. And I agree with the Holy Spirit that have convinced me of my sin. I realize I have sinned. See, I realize that I have sinned. I didn't stop there. But also, I went further also to agree with the Holy Spirit that gave me conviction that I have sinned. So the main word for admission tonight is that what? Agreement. You see, many of us, when the Holy Spirit brings conviction to our sin, make us to be aware of sin, how many of us actually agree with him? That is the issue here. How many of us actually agree with him? Has it not happened to you in the real life? You know, there's some people that have gone wrong, they have made the mistake. You try to make them understand that everything you've gone wrong, and yet their heart going. Nobody has him, man. You get paid up with them. You just leave them and say, I will send you to correct it. And see, when he has occurred again and again, so also the Holy Spirit. The only the Bible, says in the book of Genesis, the Bible says that the Spirit of God will no longer strive with man. What is trying? Trying to fight with you, trying to contend with you, trying to fight all this to convince you. No, he doesn't do that. The Spirit will carry with your Holy Spirit. He's a gentle spirit. He's very kind. That is why when you see his fruit, his character in the book of Galatians 5 from verse 22. One of the characters the Bible recorded concerning this is that one. Is gentleness, very calm. That is why when you don't follow him with kindness, you misses him, you misses his voice. He's very gentle. He leads you calmly, gently. Praise the Lord. Amen. So when he's telling you that this thing is wrong, you better admit it and you admit it on time. Let's say the Bible, you know, two different people, the way they reacted to their sin, and you know, I ended up at the end of the day. Then let's see the book of Psalm 51. Let's see. Somebody we can learn from there. Psalm 51, verse 3 to 4. Yeah, there before me, you can help me out. Psalm 51, 3 to 4.
Psalm 51, 3 to 4, I read. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. For against thee, thee only have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You see, who is talking here is David, our brother, in the scripture. What is happening? Why did this psalm came about? It's when Nathan, when he slept with Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, and he ended up killing Uriah. Remember the story in the book of 2 Samuel chapter 11, when he's supposed to go to war, that David refused to go to war, and he happened to see Bathsheba and he slept with her, and he got her pregnant, and when she discovered she was pregnant, he had to maneuver the whole thing, that the husband Uriah comes from the battlefront, and when he came, he tried all he can, got him drunk, did everything he can to make sure that the man goes to sleep with the wife, so that the secret will not be discovered, so that he would not say that the man got the wife impregnated, which was totally lie. You know, God, there's nothing hidden from our God. In case you are here, you think you are faster than God, we are just deceiving ourselves. That is the truth. That was what David was trying to do. Yes, everything he succeeded in concealing the whole thing. He planned it and he worked for him. He killed the man Uriah. Nobody knew about it. But what happened? I don't think the wife Bathsheba knew the thing that he was the one that killed the husband. But what happened at the end of the day? God asked, you know, one thing I know about God. There is no speciality with God. That's what the wife said. You know, yes, God, there are some people God esteem more than other people. But God does not esteem you too much that he covers up your sin. No. He doesn't do that. There is something God hates. If there's anything that separates us from our God, they say, remember the book of Isaiah 59, verse 1. He said, my heart is not too short that I cannot see. Neither my ears are too heavy that I cannot hear you when you call. He said, what has separated me and you is your sin. So when it comes to God dealing with us, when we miss it, immediately he exposes it. Yes, when it falls to us, it's where we refuse to hear, then begin to send message to other people to us because they don't want us to end up in destruction. Look at, he has to expose the secret to Nathan. I wonder before he exposes it to Nathan, maybe he has talked to David. David just called it one of those things. Doesn't mean have to raise the king. Nobody's coming to chastise him. But God has to send Nathan, the prophet, to David and say, go and warn David. And after Nathan has warned David, yeah, I said in Second Samuel chapter 12. In 2 Samuel chapter 12 from verse 1, Nathan went to David, rebuked David and everything. And look at what David now confessed to God. That is where we read now. He says that what David responded and said, for I have acknowledged my transgression and my sin is ever before me. I have acknowledged my transgression. My dear, have you acknowledged your transgression? Is your sin ever before you? Have you acknowledged your shortcoming? Have you acknowledged and asked God, I missed it. Look up here, I made a mistake. I shouldn't have done this. I just did this. Lord, have mercy on me. Look at what this guy was saying. He said, for I have acknowledged my transgression. My sin is ever before me. My sin is ever before me. Not to say that, what, God, I have not done anything. God, you are just judging me for nothing. No, he has to admit immediately. He said, I have acknowledged my transgression and my sin is ever before me. I'm trying to look it from another translation because I saw it another translation and the thing really pleased my heart while preparing for this message. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm trying to use the phone to get to it. There is no opening. But well, let's see that. I don't know why it's not responding. Amen. The New Living Translation. Trying to look at it. Amen. But let's see verse 4. He said, against thee, thee all have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest. Look at what he's saying. He said, God, I realize I have sinned against you. He said, yes, when you are to judge me, he said, you are justified, that you are right. You are right when you judge me, because I know I missed it. I know I cursed it. I know I have erred against you. So you are right. Your judgment is, very, very right. What you want to do with me is that it's very right. I don't go against what you are saying, how you want to judge me. Praise the Lord. So in a nutshell, this guy, God, baby, he admitted it. Praise the Lord. Let's go forward to see the book of Genesis chapter 10, verse 9 to 13. Then before we see that, let's see Second Samuel 12 to 13. To confirm what I'm saying. Second Samuel 12 to 13. Let's see David's confession there. Second Samuel 12 to 13. If you are there, let me have 2 Samuel 12 to 13.
2 Samuel 12.
Yes, verse 13. 12 to 13. No, chapter 12, verse 13. After David has sinned and Nathan has rebuked him, look at what his statement. Please go ahead.
Okay. And David said unto Nathan, have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die.
Thank you. He said, I have sinned against the Lord. Look at David's confession. I have sinned against the Lord. Then let's move to Genesis. Let's compare it to somebody else here. Genesis chapter 3, verse 9 through 13. Take it from verse 9.
Genesis 3, verse 9. Mm-hmm. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? Verse 10, and he said, I heard the voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself.
Okay, please, because of time, let us see verse 12 and 13. 12 and 13.
And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat.
Okay, praise the Lord. You see what is happening here? What we read? Where we read from verse 12. Is that when actually what happened? When God created Adam and Eve, put them in the Garden of Eden. It's a story that we are conversant with. And God told them, don't eat the fruits from the tree at the middle of the garden. They disobeyed. and they went to leave. And when they did, they discovered they were naked. One day, God came as usual to come and fellowship with them, and he saw them. When he actually got there, he was not able to see them because they knew that they were naked, and they went to hide themselves. And God gave them a call, and he says that we are naked, we cannot come. Then God has to ask them, who told you we are naked? And look at Adam's response. He called on Adam. Who told you we are naked? Verse 12 took it from. Say, and the man said, which is Adam, the woman who that gave us to me, gave us to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I did eat. Look at Adam giving an excuse. God told him, have you eaten of the fruit I told you? He said, yes. And instead of him, he said, God, have mercy on me, forgive me. Look at excuses. He said, God, yes, I had the fruit. In fact, it is the woman, if you get to me, that made me to eat this one. That's to say, left for me, I would have eaten this one. I wasn't interested. It was this woman that you get to me. That's trying to shift the blame back to God. I said, God, I was on my own. I stayed on my own. It was you that gave me this woman. And this one you say is supposed to be a solution. Hey, help me. It's not a problem to me. And you, he told God like that. And God went ahead and asked the woman, which is verse 13. And the Lord said unto the woman, what is that, this that God has done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did it. And the woman too gave excuses and said, it is the serpent, the devil, that made me to it. The woman also shed blood for the serpent. You see, that is also, you know, when we read stories like that, hey, Adam and Eve, why did they eat this one? But what about we? Is it not how we take blame today? We give excuses here and there. Well, we miss this, and God is saying, this is it. The Holy Spirit, you know, we are talking about what do you do when you fall into sin. The Holy Spirit convinces us. And the point we are in is that, you know, we admit it and confess us. Instead of we to admit and confess, what do we do? We try to give excuses. We try to dodge it. We try to cover it up. And God is not pleased. Why do I know God is not pleased? Because if we have time, we have read this Bible down, because we don't have time, God has to bring judgment to them. God has to see when God says you don't do something or we do it like this. When we don't do it, we don't have anybody. God will not earn anybody responsible. It is you that gave the command. It is you that gave the command. It is you that gave the command. That is why when in a relationship, we have to be very, very careful. Why being involved in a relationship with somebody that is not going the same direction you are going? I hear some people are saying that, well, you know, I know it's not a Christian. When we get married, I will convince, I will convert him, or I will convert her. Or even a so Christian home, the husband is going this way because the wife wants to please the husband, he joined the husband to go to the same direction. No, I'm not saying that there should be always war between husband and wife. When you know your husband is behaving against the law of God, or your wife is misbehaving against the law of God, instead of quarreling, I'm not saying don't chastise or that don't, you should not correct. Correct. But when you see that correction every time is leading to war, problem, when you have that, just keep quiet, that's all, they don't keep quiet and stop there. Don't keep quiet and stop there. I repeat myself. Don't keep quiet and stop there. No, you are making a great mistake. You can keep quiet just a piece of it, but let your knees speak on behalf of that man, on behalf of that woman. If you love that man as a husband, if you love that woman as a wife, speak to God continuously on behalf of that vessel. Speak to God. I'm looking for a man that will stand in the gap. If there's someone that can pray on behalf of his neighbor, because of your prayer, God can save that soul. Because of the prayer, God can redirect that life. Because of your prayer, God can deliver that life. Because of your prayer, that person can have a new beginning. That is the goal of sight. If somebody can stand in the gap. Because at times we want to use our own power. You discover it is not working. But if you come to a time, the person who sees as if you are overriding him or pressing him or her. No. I remember years ago, there's a sister I used to know very well. There's a church. In fact, I knew her in a particular church. We all started together. And I came with I was no longer at ease with that church. So I had to, you know, I'm not condemning any church here. So I will not mention the name of the church. So I had to leave the church. So since I know that salvation was not properly preached in that church, what do I have to do? And this is my close friend. I have to try to convince her she was not interested. You know what happened? But what am I saying in that one? When you have talked to people, talk to them, leave them alone. Leave, they begin to see you as an enemy. What now happens is that, well, then this that sees me, start dodging me. He starts dodging me. I didn't even know. Because when I no longer see her again. It was later when she herself got converted. She met one that she was very happy. She hugged me. I was very happy to see her radiant face. I was like, where you used to be? And she now told me, I must confess to you, I've been excused. Let me just tell you, do you know I've been avoiding you? I said, why? He said, because I know each time you see me, it's every time Jesus, 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 Jesus. So I was set up with part of your gospel. So I didn't even want to set my eyes on you again. You see, she started avoiding me. So that day, I learned my lesson and said, yes, I will speak, but when I see that it's coming for, I rather be something on my knees. Am I scared of she avoiding me? No, that is not it. That is nothing. But the thing is that I wanted that to be free where I am. Praise the Lord. Because actually, it's not me that does the conviction. It's the Holy Spirit. But thank God at the end of the day, she became born again and she knew the light as she came out of darkness. And I see God using you to deliver somebody also in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You see, many a times also, when we confess, when we don't, after we have, you know, realized as if we have admitted, God, you know, God does not expect us to stop there. You know, in the course of my teaching from the beginning, I said from the onset, admit or confess. One way we admit is that we can admit our sin when the Holy Spirit convinces us inside our hearts. Then I guess God expects us to go beyond that to say to our mouth. Our mouth means confession. You speak it. So at times when we speak our sin to God, God, I have sinned, forgive me. You have not noticed that it doesn't stop there. At times I feel on this. You are not yourself. You have confessed your sin to God. You have apologized. He forgive you. At times you are still rested. Perhaps God wants you to take a step forward to confess it to one another. Please, this is very, very delicate in today's Christianity. This is very, very crucial in today's Christianity. Let's run to the Bible, the book of James chapter 5. James chapter 5 verse 16. Let's see here. James chapter 5 verse 16. We are there, help us out. And yeah, I think there's a big story, a big lesson here for we all to learn. James chapter 5 verse 16.
James 5 16 says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much.
Okay, thank you. Let's take it step by step. Number one, it says that confess your faults one to another. That's at times God expects us to confess to one another. Why does he do so? He went further to explain. He says that and pray for one another. You just missed it. You just came against God. You saw something that is not yours. And you ask God for feeling. Your spirit is so restless. You know you are not yourself. You just slept with somebody you are not supposed to sleep. Not in covenant, marriage, covenant, relationship with. You know, one thing or the other, you just said that your spirit is so restless. God can be leading you to confess it to somebody. And why did he say so? He says, I will pray for one another. He's asking to confess to somebody, a brother, a sister in the faith. Why? Because he expects that person to join you in prayer, to pray on your behalf. That's to say that tomorrow God can lead somebody to me or lead somebody to you that can come and make a confession. It is not for we are the behind. You're not carrying the person. God might be doing a protocol. We are not seeing the person behind us. Immediately, some of us, if the person just drop the phone or comes like that, is that some people did not avoid conversation on phone. Because as we noticed, many a time people are having conversation on phone. Some people just record, which is not doesn't come for at night. You know, immediately that's why some people want to talk to you face to face. Any hype might be, you know, when because it's not like immediately the person just so even if it comes to your house, immediately it leave. It's just for you to give a call to the next person. Have you not had? Have you not, in fact, he or she just left my house now, or she just finished talking to me now? Have you heard what he has said? See, what is in life, my dear brethren? See, you can tell me something, you know, confident, you know, have confidence in me, and you tell me, you know, you feel you can confide in me. And I goes out, you know, what I'm not supposed to do, I take it to Mr. A to talk to. Do you know that's what? I feel the person that came to talk to me feel that way, trusted me. No knowing on his behalf, I've come to talk to Mr. A. And I that went to what I went to tell Mr. A, I said that Mr. A should keep his friend because in the presence of me telling Mr. A, what we do most of the time, said, I'm only telling you, it didn't have to be better. I just see you should know. That's what I'm only telling you. But unknown to me, when I leave Mr. A is going to tell Mr. B. Mr. B is going to tell Mr. Y. And that is, and you know, life, this class is a very, very short place. It's a very, very short way. Somebody said that the world is like a global village. You see, before you know, that world turned around and get to the ears of the first person that told me about this or life. And who is ever happy with such situation? Tell me, let's be honest. I know we are falling sin or we're not falling guilty of this thing one time or the other. But why is this coming up? Is that we have to be very, very careful. People should be able to look up to me or look up to you to confide in. Because if you cannot confide in ourselves as Christians, who do we not confide in the people of the world? No. No. Because if we do, we are selling ourselves for destruction. The Bible says, when we raise our confess your fault. See, the Bible even said, confess your fault only to God. He said to one another, to a human. That's to say, God is still even relying on us to do something, that we can do something on his behalf, because we carry his spirit. If God is seeing us as useless, as worthless, that's why we are Christian. He would have said that word, we should confess one our fault to one another. You know what? The people, somebody to come and confess his fault to one another, because every human being has ego to some extent. That is it. All of us will have some, you know, some pride to us. Even God, sorry to use that word again. I think I'm just inviting that word pride. That's to say that one. There's some respect to ourselves. I think that's the right one. You know, even God has some respect to himself. So everyone has some respect. So for somebody for me to come down to that level to come and tell you my shortcomings, it means that what there's an esteem I respected you. Because if I don't respect, I would have just announced myself to the whole world. Then what's the thing? We should pray for one another. When the person tells you something, come and say, bring your hands, brother. Let's join our hands in prayers. And that brings you to lift up that person before God. And that is why you have to be very, very careful who you release yourself. It's very, very important. And that was when you said, after the prayer, what is the prayer that God, that ye may be healed? That is a prayer supposed to bring healing. That's to say that one, there are some confession. Until you confess, you are not healed. That is where again we make mistake. We do something we think we can cover it up. We say that when we are confessing to God, after all, I've exposed just like this book. I think I've done more than that. You know, when we confess ourselves, that's exposing peace. That's what confession is. I'm exposing before God. So God is finished now. No, there are times God's going to expose this to somebody. It might be somebody you've seen their gaze. It might be said, God, I can pray for you. And God was after all this, and then you are healed. Some of us, we are not healed, maybe emotional because of what we did. Some of us, we are not healed at times, maybe also because spiritually, because of what we have done previously. Some of us, we are not healed also physically on our body because of what we have done. How do you know that you are not healed? By the time the thing always play back on your memory, it always play back. You are praying that you are praying, you are praying. Probably God is saying that, well, go and tell this person that you are wrong. Go and tell this person higher than you that can join you in prayers. Praise the Lord. No, this is not common to this proceeding. That is why I am emphasizing on it. But if I is not common, doesn't mean that it's not in the word of God. It's still very, very much alert in the word of God. And God will help us in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And please, I want to say, yeah, please, hidden sins destroyed. Anything that has been hidden, it will destroy somebody. Anything that has been covered up. Let's see the book of Psalm 32. Psalm 32, 3 to 5. Psalm 32, 3 to 5. Let's see quickly what the Bible is telling us here. I would prefer Living Bible, Living Translation, because of time. I would have read it from PJs then. We look also Living Bible because of time. Let's just go to the Living Translation. That will really break it down tonight to our understanding. Psalm 32, verse 3 to 5. I read verse 3. He said, this, you know, when I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away. When I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away. And I groaned all day long. That I was not myself. And like I'm carrying the body within me. The source said, day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy upon me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Look at the confession of a man here. He said, when I refuse to confess my sin, I lost my peace. He said, you see, when the sun is very hot, the way water, it will put water in the container. The way water, that container gets dry easily because it has evaporated easily because of the heat of it. So that is how the sin was, that the body was eating me up. I could no longer be as myself. But that container that carries water during the hot summer, if the way the water is leaving that container, if the container has man, it will actually crash. That is not easy. So this man said that is how his life became. But look at the way it ended up, verse 5. He said, finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord and you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. You see? So when I confess all my guilt, I felt at ease. It's like a body that was uplifted me. It was a body that was rolled away. So anything we refuse to confess, when we try to live in it or cover it, is that we're just giving the devil a free day in our lives. Don't do whatever thing in life in our life. But when we confess, God forgives. When we read verse 5, 7, 2, verse 5, he said, he forgives us our sin. And when we look at 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, he says that when we confess and confess our sins, he says, it's just to forgive all our sins. It's just and faithful to forgive all our sins. Something about God. God is faithful to forgive all our sins. Let's see Hebrews chapter 8, verse 12. Hebrews 8, 12. God talks about confession to God also again. What happened when we confess? Hebrews 8, where?
Hebrews 8, 12, I read.
Go ahead.
For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more.
Okay, you see, he said, I will be merciful to their unrighteousness. He said, their sin and their iniquities will I remember no more. When we confess, he will be merciful. Our sins and iniquities will not remember anymore. And one great man of God that ever lived, he said something. Boom, Ten Karen says something. He says that when God forgives a man his sin, he says he throws it at the sin, the ocean of forgetfulness. There's an ocean God forgets when God will throw it there, and he will put a sign, say no fish. What does it mean that when God forgives you your sin, he doesn't remember them anymore again? He sees you as white as snow. He does not recognize your past. He is more not concerned your present than your past. So in case you that still covering up, God is not instead you want you to dig it up. Do you know that anything you call back, we need to conquer you? We need to go walk in it. You feel there's no, we are not going to look at the Bible verses. I will just use my man. You look at the life of Judas Iscariot very well. The way he started his life, he started well with Jesus. It wasn't wayward from the beginning. Because the Bible says when Jesus was selecting his disciples, he prayed all through the night before he could select his disciple. And when actually he prayed all the night before he could select his disciple, so for him to have prayed the night, that he was extremely careful. He was extra careful. And when he picked the 12 of them, including Judas Iscariot, the Bible says that along the line, Judas went wayward. Because the Bible says that he was in charge of the money bag, he was a treasurer. So once in a while, he goes here to go and take money. He wants money to take care of himself according to the Bible. And eventually, because he repent, he didn't repent. Because I want to believe initially, does it not happen to you as a Christian? You do something wrong, your mind strikes you. We read about that place, I think 2 weeks ago or so, concerning David when he cut the hem of the master's garment. So the Bible says his heart smote him as a Christian. Because God is proof, God is proof. God said, no, don't do this thing. Without nobody saying, your mind, this will be a different. This thing is wrong. Yes, I want to believe that was the case of this Judas Iscariot. The way he started stealing the money from the money's back, he still would appear with me and say, stop this act. But he refused, he convened, he insisted. And what happened? He ended up betraying Jesus just for 30 pieces of silver. He didn't know that would be in his hand. If he has been going to continue. See, anything we insist in continuing, ignoring the voice of God, it will end that person in destruction. It will end that person in where he never expected it would end up. May that not be your portion in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We are drawing to a close because of time tonight. Amen. Then let's see again what does God expect from us to do when we fall. What to do when you fall as a Christian. Then after admitting your sin, the next thing you have to do is that we'll forsake. Forsake. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 13. Let's quickly run there. Proverbs 28, verse 13. Forsake that sin. 28, 13. If I want to see two things here. Proverbs 28, 13.
Proverbs 28:13.
Yes,
ma'am. He that covereth his sin shall not prosper, but whoso confess and forsake then shall have mercy.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He said, he that covers his sin shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Look at two things there. He that covers his sin said there is no prosperity. That when you refuse to confess your sin. But he says something, they say, but whoso confess and forsake, then shall have mercy. That for confess alone, where the point we just ended, confess alone, it is not enough. The next step before I said that is to forsake. What does it mean to forsake that? Abandon, reject, not going back again. Abandon that thing, reject is not going back again. The Bible says that when you forsake like that, after confessing, you forsake, then the message of God comes into play. I see somebody receiving the message of God tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. I see Amen. The message of God transforming your life in the name of Jesus. Amen. You are Amen. Living here tonight with a testimony in the name of Jesus. Amen. The message of God turning your life around in the name of Jesus. Amen. You don't deserve that message, but because it's a message of God, we're ready to.
Amen.
God is a God of love. He doesn't desire your soul to perish. Receive the message of God who has said tonight in the name of Jesus. From tonight, you are a new person. From tonight, you are a new person. I will say, after Samuel, your father met with Samuel, he left him with a new spirit, with a new person. The same thing I declare upon you tonight in the name of Jesus. Amen. A new heart to serve God. A new heart to obey his commandment. A new heart to betray his son. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He said, he that covers his sins shall not prosper. But he that confesses and confess and forsake the Lord will have them. That's the thing that today is a correlation. There's a connection between confession and forsaking. Confession and forsaking. That is why the Bible brought the two together. Because many a times we confess, we don't forsake. We'll confess and say, God, I don't want it again. Then we run back. We'll run back. We need to do it again and again. The Bible says, shall we continue sin because grace might have gone? Book of Romans chapter 7 said, God forbid. And the Bible says that what, you know, when you confess your sin and you forsake, you know what you just do? Exactly when you confess it, you just expose the works of darkness. According to the book of Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11. Ephesians 5, 11. Let's see that, please. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11.
Ephesians 5, verse 11.
Yes.
And I have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Praise the Lord. I have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. What is the unfruitful works of darkness? It seems wrongdoing. Say, don't have any fellowship with them. He says that what, rather reprove them. Another version is that rather expose them. That reprove, he says, I will expose them. That's when you confess, you are exposing them. You are naked. You just make naked the works of the devil. Just expose them. You just disgrace them. So please, when you confess, you're not actually exposing yourself. You are disgracing the devil. That's the truth. Don't be deceived. You are deceived. The devil has made us believe you confess. Hey, they will mock at you. This one, because the devil says that you are going to disgrace him. So for you not to disgrace, instead to make you to believe you are disgracing yourself. No, it is he you are disgracing. And the Bible says that when you confess and when you expose them, say, reprove them, don't have any fellowship with them. What shall you do? You are breaking yourself free from the stronghold. No wonder the Bible says in the book of James chapter 4, verse 7, it says, resist the devil and you will flee. Because when you now separate yourself, you confess, you are separating, you are exposing him. What have you done is that war? You are resisting. You are enough free from you. He now run away from you. You see yourself being free, being totally delivered from the stronghold. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. And you see that in the book of Acts chapter 9, verse 20 to 21. Cannot read it because of time. The life of Apostle Paul. The life of Apostle Paul, this man was something that we all surely know. His life was that he went to destroy the believers all around. He lived a notorious life, a wayward life, to the fact of slaughtering human beings. He doesn't care, doesn't sin. He thought he was pleasing God. But when God actually arrested him, he became a different being entirely. It become a different. Do people see you transform? That is a question we should ask ourselves. Because when you look at the life of this man, people saw him that he was transformed. People saw him as a new person. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's bring her that to this. Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9. Verse 20 from verse 20. But we cannot say because of time. Let's just say 25 to 30. Acts chapter 9, 25 to 30. Acts chapter 9, 25 to 30. Are we there? Let's see the new life this man lived. Harry, say 25.
Okay.
Then the disciples took him by night. That's from Apostle Paul now. And let him down by the wall in a basket. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he had said to join himself to the disciples. But they were all afraid of him. And believe not that he was a disciple. You see, they were afraid, scared of him, because they know that he was a wayward, nobody. They were afraid that he wants to come and destroy them because they knew his plight before. And they didn't want to identify with him. But look at verse 27. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he has seen the Lord in the way, and that he has spoken to him, and how he has freed God at Damascus in the name of Jesus. And he was with them coming in and going out to Jerusalem. He said, when Barnabas was not convinced them that he's a changed man, they didn't even stop there. They had to align to stay with them, verse 28. The Bible says it was with them going and coming. That he stayed with them. They were checking his character. That's to say, people are still looking at us. You that say you have confessed, you have changed. People are still watching you. They are still washing you. Consider it really you have changed. Praise the Lord. Amen. I don't have the time without sharing the story with us tonight. Consider it really you have changed. He said, and he break and he spoke boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus. And he stood there, they gave the Galatians, but they went about to slay him. Which, when the brethren knew, they brought him back to Caesarea and sent him forth to Tarsus. So they came to see that his life has changed. That's Apostle Paul. And the brethren were not happy to associate with him. You know, some of us are saying that, well, people doesn't like us, people doesn't want us around, because maybe they see suspected, there are some things in you, some traces of your old life in you. We declare you have changed, but actually you are not changed. So people, they are still afraid to associate with that. True. Nobody wants to associate with a criminal. Nobody wants to associate with a liar. Nobody wants to associate with a betrayer. Let's be realistic. You be human. Will you be willing to associate with somebody that have some dubious or negative character? You wouldn't. So why do you expect people to associate with you when you have such character? Because when you do, people that associate with you, at the end of the day, they are like you. Yes, they say best of the same bed that flocks together. And the Bible even says further to explain. Amos chapter 3, verse 3. Say, can two walk together? Say, they are me. But if two of us are walking together, it means that we're in agreement. There's something that binds us together. If you're a thief, I'm walking with you. That means that we're indirectly, I'm a thief. That's it. Team. So if you want people that are good to associate with you, then put your life to be good also. Very, very important. Because what we're talking about, not actually the kingdom. We're talking about access here. Let's represent the kingdom very well. God will help us as we do so in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. We'll stop here because of time. So that we can go ahead with our prayers later on. Amen. God bless you tonight. Before I leave you tonight, we want to partake in the Holy Communion, which is a custom that we are used to in this place. God bless you. This is our tradition, what God has commanded us to do every time we have said. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now we just pray by our Father in the name of Jesus. Lord, we release your presence over this Holy Communion. As we take it, we take life. In the name of Jesus. Let the sick receive it, oppressed believer, seeking for solution, receive it, direction, receive it. No, remember the same at the end of the day in Jesus' name. The word said, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden.
You just take it.
So we begin to identify with you, Lord God, tonight. Lord, through this Holy Communion, grant them rest in your soul. Wherever they are troubled, grant them deliverance. Pray for testimony at the end of the day in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, sir. Take sweet in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you all for taking your time to listen. Thank you for your wonderful comments, which I'm still expecting, have been a lot of encouragement to me. You see, when you watch videos, don't just keep silent about it. Drop one or two comments. That goes to tell the person that you have had the message, you are receiving, that he or she is communicating. Not only my videos. When you watch videos, you know, pictures, you know, people post pictures and you love it. Just drop one or two comments. It goes to give a lot of encouragement to the person that is doing the work. Praise the Lord. God help you as you do so in Jesus' name. And those of you that be sharing the video, I want to encourage you also. I do not take you for granted. Please continue to share the video myself. The reward that comes to me, the same reward that will come to you also. Because there are places I cannot go to. There are people on your world that I don't have as friends, that you can add also to help with this gospel of the Lord Jesus. And I see you, God blessing you in return in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And God bless you. Thank you for making yourself available. That come across your way next week, remember, blessed. Remember, everywhere says 7:30 on the door. Or if we delay a little, please pardon us, maybe 7:35 or 7:40. God bless you. Remember, blessed. Bye.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
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 Devotion.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
God bless you all. Good evening, all to everyone. Thank you for making yourself to come and fellowship tonight. Please question or contribution. Something I say you don't understand or agree with. Remember, this is we are here in learning. For the fact I am teaching doesn't mean I know it all. Yeah, please be free to speak. Please be free to speak. It's a house of God. The Bible says, wherever the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. Please be free to express yourself. You want to contribute also, you are free. You want to argue a point, you are free. If I cannot give answer, the Spirit of God can still take charge of another person to help us out. God bless you as you do so tonight. Amen. I'm listening. Please go ahead, man. God bless you, man.
I have a contribution, man. Because number two, you said, admit or confess your sin. So yes, ma'am. One of the Bible verses you read is James chapter 5, verse 16. So yes, we should confess our faults to one another. So my advice to us this evening is that when you are confessing your sins to one another, you should be careful of whom you are confessing your sins to.
That's true.
For the fact that we all were in the house of God doesn't mean that we all are believers. I keep on saying it. You study the person you are going to confess to. If the person's spirit is aligned with the spirit of God, if the person has the spirit, the grace to resist it, you can confess to the person. Like maybe, for instance, now, paravention, that God forbid, maybe a woman or a man, can be vice versa, maybe fornicated. Then you say, because this person is my church member, let me go and confess to this person. Before you know it, the whole church will know. And before you know, your husband will know. So before you know, that can, if you are not careful enough, that thing can scatter your home. Amen. So you should study the person you are confessing to before you can confess. Because these days, I tell you the truth, man, just that because time is no longer on our side, I would have throw more light on it, because I know what I'm saying. Because these days, the church we are practicing these days, it's not those church that, that was in the Bible that we are even doing in our Sunday school now. What we are dealing with now is the church. If you look at that memory verse we are using in Sunday school now, that Acts chapter 2, verse 42. You see, and they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowshipping, and in breaking of bread and in prayer. So when you read God, you see, even the people, they were outsiders, people that doesn't even know God, they were amazed seeing the fellowshipping, the cooperation in the house of God. But this day, it's no longer like that again. You can see a believer today, instead of that believer to confide with a fellow believer, a fellow Christian brother or sister, they prefer to go and make friends. The one be confessing their sins to outsiders that doesn't even know God. So that is the problem we are having in ministries today. When you see people, we call people to come to the house of God, they will say, no, I'm not coming. No, if that person can call him or herself a Christian, me, I will go to heaven. So it ought not to be. And in conclusion, I want also, to take this verse very strongly. Like Romans chapter 8, you quoted it before we started this this Bible study. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. People can, when we are praying with God, you can quote Bible to your benefit. We can quote that there is no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. But when you look at the B part of it, you say, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. So when you walk after the spirit, you don't have condemnation. But when you are still, still doing evil, when a fellow brother will come to you and confess his or her sin to you, and you are not able to bear it, you begin to narrate that person. So you are condemned already. I pray God Almighty will help us in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you very much, Jikinez. That was a great one. Please, I beg here, is for every one of us. No, when we hear the word of God, let's forget about the next neighbor. To settle yourself first. Not like the church or the Christian gatherings is like hospital. An hospital, you go there, not basically, the time we go for a visit. But people that inhabit that hospital, they are staying there because of their sickness. No person that is totally fit, having no problem, you go to the hospital bed and lie down. It has no business. In fact, when you are in the hospital, you can't be sick. In fact, when you get fit, they send you out because you no longer belong there. So in the church also, where nobody is perfect, nobody is having, so all of us, we have having one thing or the other. So when you hear the Christian gathering, when you share something, don't be thinking of your next neighbor. It is yourself we are talking about. It's me that decision, it's myself I'm talking about. Yeah. So when we are talking about not thinking of the next neighbor, it will say this, but that day, I forget, come hear this message. I go for a major call here. Even if they're talking about people matter. Or if that's the no, you go work out a you say talk about yourself, think about yourself. You they do one, I got the thoughts, maybe we all repent. Because in fact, when I was preparing this topic, I looked it on myself. I said, God, have mercy. I remember some things that in the past, I have to quickly say, God, have mercy on me, forgive me. You understand? So that is what we are talking about here. So I will stop here because of time. Question or contribution? Please.
Yeah, just
a contribution.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Just added to what our sister just said. And really, some people are like that. And Apostle Paul also made sure to understand that if we all, if we think that we are perfect, meaning that we are lying,
Yes.
Said, how did he put it? Not enough. I just read the voice. Said,
Jesus is not enough. Yes. You are deceiving ourselves.
Yes. So Jesus Christ didn't come for the righteous. He came because of the sinner. So we are all, how do I say it? So we are learning. So as we stick to the word of God and practicing the word every time, then, you know, we make our point and make our way straight before him. So we are all sinners.
Thank you very much, sister. So that is it. We are learning. We are sinners. And God does not expect us to remain our sin. We are to change.
That's
true. From glory to glory, we are to change. The thing I used to do yesterday, I should not continue doing it today. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Okay. Please, ma'am. Say you have questions. Go ahead, ma'am. We are hearing.
Who is Nata?
Okay. So who is Nata? Nata in the Bible, where we read, because of time, we're not actually speaking to details. He was a prophet of God. He was a prophet, a man of God, but he was into a prophetic ministry. So many a times, God will send him a message to go and speak to the king in Israel, like King David, to go and tell him some messages, you know, like in our today churches, you know, that some prophet, they will tell some people, see what God is saying, though.
Yes.
That is how Nathan was. Amen. Have we answered your question? Yes, so go and correct David of his sin. Just as God will send men to us today when we sin. But the difference here is today that today some people, some of us, will correct us when we sin, for we can able to accuse that person and know and he is a sinner. You know, he's a liar. May that not be our portion in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to be praying with the next few minutes we have. I'm going to be praying. Amen. God is said to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He has promised he will never fail. I will lean on him. I will trust in him. God has promised he will never fail. His faithfulness is forevermore. His faithfulness is forevermore. Let's open our mouth and thank God tonight. Let's thank God for the word we have had. Let's give him all the praise. Let's exalt the King of Peace, the Lord of Stuff. Father, we thank you tonight. We give our praise. We lift up your name on high. Thank you. Thank you for the word we have had. We give you all the praise. We give you all the praise. We give you all the praise. Reign and be exalted. Reign and be glorified. Reign and be lifted up. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Because you taught us so much things, you are saying to your word. Lord, thank you. Lord, thank you. Lord, thank you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
See, thanking God. I want to thank God for not allowing us to perish in our sins. For being a God of mercy, for having mercy on us every now and then. Let's open our mouth and thank him. Because if not for your mercy, you and I would have been destroyed. Let's thank him. Father, I thank you for your mercy upon my life. Because God to say the truth, no one is actually worthy to stand before you. The Bible says, if you are to count iniquity, who is it that will stand? None is righteous to God. Our righteousness is like a filthy rag. Hence, God, King of glory, Jehovah, we are saying thank you, Lord God, for having mercy on our sins. Thank you, Lord God, for counting us worthy because of the blood of Jesus on the cross. We exalt you tonight. We exalt you tonight. We exalt you tonight. We exalt you. We give a praise. We give a praise. We give a praise. We give a glory. Blessed be your holy name. Blessed be your holy name. In Jesus' name, we have given thanks.
Amen.
We want to pray tonight is a merciful God. It's not enough to hear the word of God, but to put it into action. Especially when you hear it immediately, not saying tomorrow. Immediately, God, no love those that respond to his word immediately. We want to pray tonight and say, God, have mercy on me. In praying this thing, this prayer, don't just pray. In fact, before you pray, look into your life very well. You might not even need to speak out. You know that things are easily before you. You know that usually conquer you. I want you at this junction and say, God, have mercy on me. The grace to overcome it. Open your mouth and begin to talk. It's a very, very serious moment. Talk to your God. Talk to your God. Talk to your God. It's the only one that can help. My Father, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rabasundo yekele. In the name of Jesus, grace, oh God, to say no to envy and righteousness. Grace to say no to envy and righteousness. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Lord God, King of Glory, exalt a nation, sin is a reproach. And you are God, Lord God, yes, your will, Lord God, King of Glory, yes, your will, Lord. Yes, your will, Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, Santa Lava Soto, in the name of Jesus, we give a praise, Lord God, King of Glory. Thank you, thank you, thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, let's be your will of the in the name of Jesus Christ, in Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus, wonderful. God, the grace of fellowship with your word and live a prayerful life. I tell you, one of them, because of time, it was in my notes. Because of time, maybe next week we're going to look into it. Where, you know, the fastest and easiest way to conquer sin is when you actually live in the word of God. You study the word of God very well and you live a prayerful life. Sin cannot easily overcome you. Because your spirit becomes strong. When we talk about sin, it is the flesh. It is not your spirit. When your spirit is strong, you overcome the flesh. So I want to pray tonight and say, God, grace will spend time with you in your word and live a strong, prayerful life that might overcome sin. Open your mouth and pray. The grace to live and to study the word. Father, the grace to live a prayerful life and to study the word. To study the word of the prayerful life. To conquer sin in my flesh. Amen. God bless you all. Let's the few minutes we have, let's quickly take the Holy Communion. Amen. Before we call it today, let's welcome Daddy to lead us. Amen.
Praise the Lord. First Corinthians chapter 11, quickly.
For I have received of the Lord that which also I deliver unto you.
I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you.
That the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread.
Jesus, that same night in which he was betrayed, Bible says he took bread.
And when he had given thanks.
And when he has given thanks.
He break it.
He break it.
And said, take it.
And said, take it.
This is my body.
This is my body.
Which is broken for you.
Which is broken for you.
This do in remembrance of me.
Please do this in remembrance of me, yes?
After the same manner also he took the cup.
The same manner also he took the cup.
When he had supped.
When he had supped.
This cup is the New Testament in my blood.
Saying this cup is the New Testament in my blood.
This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me.
Please do this as often as you are doing in the remembrance of the Lord, yes?
For as often as ye eat this bread.
As often as you eat this bread
and drink this cup,
and drink this cup,
Jesus show the Lord's death till he comes.
You do show the Lord's death till he comes, yes.
Therefore, whosoever shall eat this bread,
whosoever shall eat this bread
and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily,
and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily,
shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord,
shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lamb, yes.
But let a man examine himself.
But let a man examine himself.
And so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup.
So let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. I want us to bow our head. I want us to examine ourselves. I want us to talk to God. Is there anything that we have committed, knowingly or unknowingly? Remember where we just were, where Mama just told us, say, admit and confess. Now, admit and confess. Anywhere you have sinned against God, ask God to forgive you, ask God to have mercy upon you. Tell God to cleanse you by his blood. Tell God to cleanse you by his blood. There's power in the blood of Jesus. Tell him to cleanse you. Tell him to cleanse you. Tell him to cleanse you. Father, thank you. As we take the Holy Communion, Lord. Thank you. Tell God what you want the Holy Communion to do for you. You are believing God for your job. You are believing God for your healing. You need healing. You need deliverance. You need miracles. Tell God, use this Holy Communion to give me my healing. To give me my deliverance. To give me my miracle. Do this Holy Communion, Lord, to bless me. Thank God, thank God, thank God. You need healing. Talk to him now. Father, thank you. Daddy, thank you. Daddy, thank you. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you adoration. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
Father, we declare this Holy Communion blessed.
Amen.
In the name of the Father,
amen.
In the name of the Son,
amen.
In the name of the Holy Ghost,
amen.
In Jesus' name. Now we can say that to our family. The blood of Jesus set me free from sins and sorrow. The blood of Jesus set me free. The blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus set me free. From sins and sorrow, the blood of Jesus set me. Oh, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus set me free. From sins and sorrow, the blood of Jesus set me free. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask that your power enter into this bread. Your spirit enter into this bread. Your anointing enter into this bread. The blood Jesus enter into this bread.
Amen.
Let this be changed and turned to the body of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let it receive the touch of power.
Amen.
Let it receive the touch of the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Let it receive the touch of the anointing of God.
Amen.
Lord, as we take this body, let the tabernacle and the temple of God join us. Let sickness and disease see us and run away.
Amen.
Let the spirit of death see us and run away.
Amen.
Let this body serve as a protection against the enemy.
Amen.
In the name of the Father,
amen.
And of the Son,
amen.
And of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, let your power enter into this food of divine. Let your spirit enter into this food of divine. Let your anointing enter into this food of divine. Let it be changed and turned to the blood of Jesus Christ. Let it receive the touch of power. Let it receive the touch of the Spirit of God. Let it receive the touch of the anointing of God. Let it receive the touch of the grace of God. Let the angel that troubled the water of Bethesda trouble this blood now in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, as we take this blood, let it heal us of every sin and every sickness in Jesus' name. Let this, the Lord, let the spirit of death see this blood and run away. Lord, let this demon called coronavirus see this blood and run away. Of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
May this God serve as a protection against the enemy.
Amen.
In the name of the Father,
amen.
And of the Son,
amen.
And of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
May this God heal cancer.
Amen.
May this God heal high blood pressure.
Amen.
May this God heal diabetes.
Amen.
May he heal cancer.
Amen.
Heart disease.
Amen.
May he heal kidney disease.
Amen.
May he heal the spirit of bending.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Thank
you, Father.
Thank
you. In Jesus' name. Now take the blood.
Thank you.
Now let's bow our head as we give God thanks. Bow your head as we give God thanks for the opportunity to take the new communion. Give him thanks. Give him praise, give him honor, give him adoration. Father, thank you for the opportunity to take this Holy Communion. We give you praise, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Take all the glory, Lord. Take all the honor. Take all the praises. Thank you. In Jesus' name, we pray. May God hear you in the days of trouble.
Amen.
May the name of God of Jacob defend you.
Amen.
May God send you help from his sanctuary.
Amen.
May God accept all your burnt sacrifice.
Amen.
May God accept all your offering.
Amen.
May God grant you according to your heart desire.
Amen.
May God heal you of every sickness and every disease.
Amen.
Every power that is troubling you and your family, may God kill those power for you.
Amen.
Every power that says you will not have peace, may God destroy them for you.
Amen.
May God fight your battle for you.
Amen.
May God give you rest in the name of Jesus Christ. May God trouble those that trouble you in the name of Jesus Christ. I cover you by the blood of Jesus. You are not permitted to die until you are more than 100 years old. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 In Jesus' name. Let's share the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. The love of God and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness shall follow all the days we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Bless you.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Deaconess, Mommy Faith. Sister Rose, please wait on the platform, please. Deaconess, Sister Rose. Mommy Faith is Mommy Faith, yeah?
Yes, sir.
Please wait on the platform. I sign out, then you will enter again. Sister Rose, Sister Oshode, Sister Deaconess Lover, please.
Wait
behind. Oh, we sign, please. We enter on the Zoom. God bless you.
Okay, sir.
Mommy, though. Mommy, UK. The door of your mouth.
I'm just saying, Nana, I'm muted.
She don't know how to, to open the Zoom.
Where's
my mic?
She's
a learned woman, so she easily.
Okay, let me quickly. Let us quickly go deep to why I said the people should wait, the leaders. The reason is that because of our church hall, you know that the last Sunday was supposed to be our last Sunday in where we are. And we are thinking, where are we going to have fellowship? So what I think was thinking was that some of you that have car will join us in Varese for the meantime. There are people that could come on their own. Like me, I do go with train. It's very easy for me to go with train. There are many people that have car can come with car. Or some people will join on Zoom till we finally got a place. But yesterday, as I was calling different people, and they were saying, no, the owner don't want to give, the owner want to give. So I decided to call one of my Italian evangelical pastor that we are supposed, I don't know whether you are aware, that I told him that we are supposed to take a place together. Yes. They are still looking for a place. And I think I said it in the last meeting.
Yes. Close to Comasina. Is it Comasina? They call that place. Yes.
Yeah, that we wanted to take together. So they saw a place. We saw the place in Comasina. They saw a place in Paderno. I told them I faith the place. So, but the place they saw, they could, because they don't have the money, it's 1,200. The one we saw was 1,200. So, but according to him, when he called the people, they have already given the place out. Mm-hmm. So, they now went to the commune to ask for a hall. So, the commune gave them a hall to use. And this Sunday, they will be starting in the place in the hall in the commune. So as I called him and I told him, look at what we have, the problem we have, and I even had an accident. He just told me to send him my address. He just drive to my house. So surprised, the Italian man just drive to my house and say, Pastor, you are not going to stay at home. Come and fellowship with us. I was surprised. He said, would you come and fellowship that, because he was waiting for them to start the place. Maybe after some time, if we don't have the place, we will now ask us to come. So that the government will need, the people will need to know them first, because somebody will be coming to open the gate for them. So then when they close, the person will come to close the gate. They only ask for 3 hours. And they know that after some time, they'll be giving them the key to enter by themselves. So that since we don't have any place now, we can come and join them and fellowship together. So he gave us the offer and he said, for now, maybe we can come and we join together as one, because the people will not know that we are not together. So maybe after some weeks, then we will now go and ask for more hours, whereby maybe they will do their own in the morning, we'll do our own in the afternoon. Because maybe they say they are supposed to start by 10 to close 12:30. So maybe they can start by 9 to close 11:30, whereby we can start at 1 by 11:30 and close by 1:30 or 1, because they will need to use the place by 2, according to him, that the commune use the place there by 2, just for we to feel gather ourselves together. So I said, okay, I will have to share with the leaders to see the possibility, whether it's okay for us or for the meantime, as we are looking for where we are going throughout the day. I've called different agents today too. So they just told me that they want to go and talk to the owner, that they don't know that the owner will accept this, our activity of gathering together, because it's the owner that decides. It's not the agent that says, it doesn't decide. It's the owner that say whether they agree or they don't agree. So I've called about 3 today too. And I'm still looking for a place. There is I don't know how far is this place from us. Settimon Milanese, maybe you can help me to check it out. I saw some more there, Settimon Milanese and Piave de Emmanuel. I don't know where that one is, Piave de Emmanuel.
That one is, wow. The Settimon Milanese is close, I think it's very close to Chetosa zone. It's not so like me. It's even more closer to me if I'm coming from this place to that place.
Which one is that? Settimon Milanese?
Yes.
I don't know the place. I've just, I see some.
Bologna, whether Bologna Road or so, something like that. Yes. It's very close to Chetosa.
But is there train? Not the close, not you with car. Is there train going there?
Yeah, so Settimon, I think there's a metro there too.
Check it from for there. Me. Check it. Check the Settimon Milanese. There are some places in Rosano.
Manuele, Piave Manuele. That place is very far. I think it's close to Roman side also.
Yeah. Okay, that one is very far. So we don't need to go to
that place. I use metro, sir. That one will be easy for them. But it's very, maybe like, I don't know, it's like a one place that is coming from Bergamo. I don't know.
Whether there's transport.
No, there's transport, yes.
There's Piazza Emanuela, Emanuele.
There's metro, I think red metro, very close to the place.
So there's some malls there also, though I didn't call there because I don't know, I've not. I know that maybe that place will be far, so I didn't want to go to where to be answered of us. So, okay, I'll say the Settimon Milanese, say that one is near. Settimon Milanese, say it's near to this, I will look that one. So that's the thing. I said, okay, let us discuss it and see whether it's okay or how we're going to do it. Or whether you people will go there first. I think maybe we'll not carry all the members to the place. Maybe you people that are leader, you'll go there to go and see the atmosphere, whether it's convenient for us this Sunday, because you know, next Sunday it's like we're going to have the women convention in Varese. I don't know whether they are really prepared. Next Sunday is the women convention in Varese, not this one that is coming, the other Sunday. So I don't know whether they are really prepared, but next Sunday we are going to know whether we are going to postpone it or we are going to go ahead. So I will say this Sunday you people should go there with all the leaders. We'll just write a message to our world that everybody should join us on Zoom this Sunday. We got a place there. You people will go there and go and look at the place, whether it's convenient or it's not convenient.
Which place that is? That Oibo place,
have you? It's just by the church there. It's just by Padeno train station.
Ah, okay.
You say it's Italian. It's Pentecostal, Italian Pentecostal people.
No, their service with our is not the same.
And now they talk so, and we understand. I say, "Mom, me go look on Sunday whether we can, whether I be, and apart from that one, see whether we can walk. Maybe Mr. Lovett will speak very well. That we can walk with them. That don't walk with them. What do I mean? What I mean that whether we can stay there till they are able to. We are able because this is their first Sunday now. They want to. Then to never even know what they want face for there. And again, they cannot say, and it's only 3 hours they give them. So that maybe we should fellowship with them. Then maybe after 2 weeks, after 3 weeks, they cannot ask to increase the hour for them from common. And maybe we cannot suggest them in doing our own in the morning, or their own in the morning, our own in the afternoon. Because the money they say the company to pay is $300 in the month, and we'll be sharing the money together. So how are we going to be paying if we are not doing our service? That's another thing you need to understand. If we don't do our service, how are we going to be paying? Because doing our service, that's when we have the offering. And we have that, we're going to give them our own part out of it. Or we do on Zoom. That's we just have to. I just have to pass the information to you, to the house, so that we can know what to do.
We are not hearing,
mommy.
I'm my Marco.
Oh yeah.
Because for me, we have to wait first so that they start their own church first. Because when they are said, they don't even know how it's going to be.
That the man said we should come. He asked me, he came to my house today. He said, we should go so that the people will see all of us for the first time. They will think that we are the same. Then coming later, they will think that maybe then come rent the place out to other people. You don't understand what I'm saying now?
I understand you, sir.
Because that's what he told me. He say, because he waiting won't be say, he never know me. Me, I never know him. So he say, if not because I say I lose the platform and say I have an accident, it's not supposed to even tell me now. It's supposed to obey me now later. Because he going to know me. He doesn't even know me. But he asked us to just come there. We are one family. We should come first. So what he wants is that we should come. That is the first day when this man will come up to the place. When they walk up, they will see everybody. They will not say, maybe they get black and Italian together. So maybe if we come to do service later, no problem. Nobody will come and ask anybody or say maybe they went and asked for another person. So that was the suggestion he was given. So that's what I said, we do not go with all the members. We do not go all the way with them. Maybe you be leaders, but we cannot stay after you leaders. We go with mama and go and see all the places. They will not make a decision when you people come back.
Problems.
You understand me? I will not make a decision when I come back. I can't be. So now come just like tell them, sir, let's do ourselves. I don't tell them, but at least when I will be the leader, mama will let them know these are the leaders. What do I just say? More ask for more time. When I do now until 11:30, we'll do our own because most of the people know the year it alone. They want to dance, they want to do some. So that we can ask, we only need 2 hours. We may not just do some school 30 minutes, do praise and worship 20, 25 minutes. Mama will pray for 30 minutes. By two hours, we're supposed to have finished service. See, it's not our place. That's what we're doing, by 2 hours. Just do papa, we just come out. For now, till we now have a problem, we cannot take some school to 1 hour, do this or this, or because normally, on your normal ground, to when you started, we start 11 o'clock to close 1:30. That is 2.5 hours. So we can cut the 30 minutes away and do it 2 hours. So maybe on this Sunday, I will send the address to all the leaders. We will not carry all the members along. Just for we to do that, we will not confuse them anything. We just go there, then we look at the atmosphere, then we'll come back here and decide on what to do. And I see them. So we send the message to war that this Sunday, everybody will join on Zoom. Man, we will write something on the wall. This Sunday, we will not have a service for them this Sunday because they are working on the hall where we are using the church hall. The government said they should put the hall down. So, but we are looking for a place. So everybody keep alert. The minute we are settled, we will ask everybody where we got. We just sent to war like that. So you people will go and look that place and see how the place look like.
And what I want to say is that, you know, there are some leaders here now, we are not complete. And you know, every Sunday, every Saturday of the month, we first Saturday, we have a leadership meeting and all that. And by grace of God, it's Saturday. So we are going to see extend this meeting to this coming Saturday, whereby we have the proper leadership meeting. So that we'll put the message on what our leaders, we should gather on Zoom as usual. So that the decision will not just be finalized by us here alone. No leader will come to where that say in not here. So that on Saturday we all will actually put our heads together what to do. So that's my what I want to suggest.
Away, Dickie, you don't see anything.
Maybe you want to go and think about it.
Okay, now on Saturday, everybody will give us this one. Abi?
On Saturday, by what time? Yeah, please, excuse me.
Mama said you are not mad, but everybody will be aware of it.
So on Saturday, can we shift it to, is Siri okay?
When are we meeting before?
4 o'clock before.
It's four.
Okay, let's leave it that four. Okay, so we write message on the 4 o'clock on Saturday. Ma?
4 o'clock, it's 4 o'clock before.
4 o'clock
on Saturday. Before, ma.
Okay, 4 o'clock on Saturday, we have a meeting, all leaders, please. So let's discuss on the matter in details.
But still looking for a place. It's not.
There's a miracle working God. Maybe in a day now, because I got can do a miracle. Who knows?
It's not a permanent.
When you get appointments,
ma?
No, I say whether you get appointments, because normally they do have four. I don't know whether you get appointment.
No. We share. We don't get what they do.
That four is okay.
Maybe just looking for a way. You know, we don't have what they are doing.
If I don't have my appointment, I can cancel it now. This one is more important to me.
The other appointment. It's when I take consider. I'm mommy leader.
No, let's leave it there, ma. No, let's leave it there for. It's okay, ma. So by God's grace, meanwhile, let's all of us still be looking. But I'm so thinking at that place you said. That's Settimo Milanese,
mama. It's not too far from the. That's you know Bonola metro station.
Bonola.
That is after we had them Sister Blessing thing. That's a metro station.
Lampugnano.
After Lampugnano, I think there's whether two stop there. If they go rough side, there you see Bonola. There I think that's zone. And then I be. After Bonola, now there's certain more Milanese thing. But I don't know whether Metro they stop for them. Maybe Metro feed they stop too. I will check and look.
I think that we're supposed to do that survey data on net, on Google.
Okay, man.
That can begin to
on Sunday, bus or a tram or any transportation so that we know. But what is important, where transport can get to.
Yeah,
and trek 5 minutes, 10 minutes for the don't reach 8 minutes.
No problem.
Thank you very much.
Okay, ma.
Okay.
Thank you all. Good night, everyone.
Good night. Okay.